Good evening, Namaskar, Hare Krishna and hello everyone. Welcome to the live session of Gyanam Foundation. Gyanam Foundation is celebrating its third edition. We are celebrating it virtually because of COVID-19 phase that everybody is going through. But still, Gyanam Foundation is determined with its aims and objectives. The aim of Gyanam Foundation is to incorporate spirituality in today's lifestyle, to give knowledge about the lifestyle to be followed by worshipping God, by praying God, by remembering the supreme power, by believing in Dharma. It also focuses on that each and every individual ought to be valued. None should be disadvantaged or discriminated, rather of any caste, creed or any discrimination. Today we have chosen this topic, a very interesting topic, and the topic is incorporation of spirituality in youth and Radha Krishna's love, how important it is in today's era. To discuss with these queries and questions, in this interactive session, we have our guest speaker, Prabhu Amit Sanadas. We will be taking a deep dive into the ocean of curiosity and spirituality, and we'll be getting the answers under the guidance of Prabhu Amit Sanadas. Today we have chosen the topic, the very important and beneficial topic for the youth, that is incorporation of spirituality among youth and Radha Krishna's love. How important it is in today's era. Today we have our guest speakers with us. He is a renowned and intellectual personality. He is going to discuss with us on these topics. And we will be taking a deep dive into the ocean of curiosity, of spirituality, and we'll be getting into the answers. So here with us, our guest speaker is Prabhu Amit Sanadas. He is a renowned personality and intellectual dignitary. He is the president of Hare Krishna movement in Mumbai and Jaipur. He is also the president of Akshay Patra, the midday meal program, that is the world's largest midday meal program that provides with the wholesome food to the children all over the country, across 13 states of India. His strength lies in to making the learning easier, to providing with the tools of learning to the youth that makes that learning easier. He is specialized in applied spirituality. So he is here with us to discuss on these topics. And I hope these topics are going to be interesting and beneficial for the youth, for the nation, for the generation. So welcome, Prabhu Amit Sanadas,
to the live session of Gyanam Foundation. Namaste, Hare Krishna. Thank you for inviting me for this talk today.
Thank you, sir. And it's my privilege to be here with the Gyanam Foundation and sitting in front of Prabhu Amit Sanadas. It's a proud moment for me also. Prabhu, I want to know, there are so many queries and questions in everybody's mind regarding Dharma, regarding spirituality. There are so many questions that lies in everybody's common man's mind. If we relate those Dharma and spirituality to youth. About youth, we can say, youth is the age of uncertainty. Youth is the age of dilemma. Youth is the age of dreaming. Today's youth, they are indulged in so many kind of negative activities. They are in the drug abuse. They are carrying weapons with them. They are indulged in the negative activities and they are diverted to the materialistic world. So youth is diverted and distracted somewhere. So my question, and we say it is said that dharma, it signifies the behavior. It is the art of living that a person should know. But nowadays, youth is lacking somewhere. So my question is there any need of spirituality to be taught to the youth? And what is the difference between dharma and spirituality?
Very good question. As far as spirituality and the need in the society is concerned, as you rightly mentioned, with all the kind of aberrations we see in present day generation or present day society, spirituality is all the more essential. And especially when a person is young, if the right foundation is built with right values, with right understanding of life, then a person can handle all the challenges which life throws up, and he can pass through those challenges and come out successful. If the right foundation of spirituality is there, then a person will not fall trap to so many temptations. These days we see rapes are on the rise, suicides are on the rise, a lot of people are going through depression, and eventually we see many people also committing suicides. We see a lot of people from very eminent institutions like IITs also taking their own lives and committing suicides. That's because the right understanding of life is not inculcated when they were young. So we strongly believe spirituality is quite different from religion. Generally, people think religion means spirituality means go to a temple and, you know, offer some arati and worship something there. Actually, spirituality is something different. It's a way of life. It's a way of life where one understands the foundation truths of life, how we have to control our minds, how we have to control our senses. And when that understanding is built in right from the early age, then a person will for sure lead a very, very balanced, holistic, and successful life.
Thank you, sir, for this answer. And I think it's going to be a very enriching session for the parents also. Because when a child grows up, parenting also matters. And when these habits are inculcated since their childhood, they are just going to learn from there only. And it can be a useful and fruitful life for them.
Yeah.
And if I say about schooling and parenting of theirs, the youth is distracted. Maybe because that is not given what was required in their childhood. So, and if I compare the education system nowadays, Lord Michaelis system we are following. And earlier it was like Sanatan Gurukul system was there. Their spirituality was taught since their childhood. And nowadays they are just leading towards the materialistic world. And they are taught to earn the money from their childhood only. In this, when we see the education, when the child is getting in the schools, they are going for some of the courses. This comes to their mind. They need to earn the money. That's why they have to choose this profession. So what do you see and how do you see the differences between that, the previous education system and nowadays Lord Macaulay's education system and early Sanatan Gurukul system?
Yeah, what you said is so true. In Vedic times, as you mentioned, there was a Gurukul system where a child from his childhood was taught these values. A child was exposed to value-based stories from Ramayana, Mahabharata, where he would understand the principles of truthfulness, principle of sacrifice, principle of discipline. And unfortunately, and earlier times, there were also joint families where a child would invariably have the company of a grandmother or a grandfather. Even if the parents were busy, they were there to spend time with the children and share with them stories and guide them, inculcate the right values. But in present times, we have nuclear families where both father and mother are working, and educational system, because of so much of pressure, everyone wants to score high marks and somehow get into the best of colleges so that, you know, they can get better jobs, they can earn more money, they can have a much more luxurious lifestyle. The whole value system has changed. But still, there's a saying, where there is a will, there is a way. Even though we may be quite against the Macaulay system of education, which is very much directed towards how we can earn more money and lead a, you know, much more, so to say, comfortable and luxurious lifestyle, still, I feel that there are institutions which are imparting values. If the parents really want their child to grow up in that kind of a culture, there is still a possibility. For example, in our institution, we have something called as Indian Culture and Values for Kids. And this initiative we are running for children in the age group of 4 years to 14 years. Now, while the child can go through the normal schooling, what he is teaching or he's learning in the schools, still, if a child enrolls for these kind of initiatives, he can get an exposure to stories from Ramayana, the wonderful values which we were talking about. So there's a saying that instead of cursing the darkness, it is better to light one candle. So although, yes, we have a lot of shortcomings in the present system, in present generation, but still, if we are determined, if we want to, there are opportunities available. Online, many courses are there. Online, many tutorials are there. Just that parents have to make up their mind, take the step in this direction of exposing their children at the right time when they are young to these values. And they should not be overly focused on that my child should get into IIT, my child should earn so much money, he should be better than other child. Rather than that, they should really focus on building a strong foundation. And if that foundation is strong, automatically the child will do well in his life. And even if they want the child to grow up in life materially and earn a lot of money, it will automatically happen if the foundation is right.
True, sir. True. I agree. And being an educator, I see in my school also, with parents, it is a problem. They are asking for the high percentage. They are asking for the scores the child is getting. They are not aware about the consciousness that is awakening in the child, what child is learning and what he is trying to get. They are focusing on the professionalism only, that this, my child, my son should be the doctor, he should be the engineer. They are not focusing what a child is trying to get from the inner soul. That is not given to the child. So those who are watching us, those who are watching this live session with Prabhuji, parents also should learn that these habits should be inculcated in the child since their childhood. And a child should be taught to learn this spirituality, to learn these values from their childhood only. And in this way, we can help our child to grow in a better way, in a better direction. And in Manusmriti, I have read somewhere, it is said that child should be sent to school. Nobody should remain at home. In today's world also, I would like to say to my viewers, please educate your child. If you are educating your child, you are educating our nation. You are building a strong nation. So with the help of this program, we are just trying to send this message to everybody. The education the child is getting from their childhood, that is the most important one. And the consciousness that awakens in their consciousness, that matters more rather than getting the scores and the grades. So if everybody, those who are watching our program, if they have queries in their mind, if they are having so many questions in their mind, they can just share your questions with us and you will be getting these answers from our Prabhuji. So Prabhuji, if we talk about Bhagavad Gita, if we talk about our divine power Krishna, the first thing that comes to our minds is the image of Radha Krishna. Why it is so that first image comes to our minds with the Krishna is the Radha and Krishna?
It's a very good question. You are very right. Even if you go to Vrindavan, there are many, many temples of Radha and Krishna. And in fact, Vrindavan, you will find many people chanting the name of Radha even more than the name of Krishna.
Right. You used to say Radhe Radhe.
Radhe Radhe. Even if you you are traveling in rickshaw or autos, so instead of people ringing the bells, if they want a way, they'll say Radhe Radhe, Radhe Radhe. So the question is, why so much prominence to Radha Rani and also to worship of Radha and Krishna? Sometimes people misunderstand that Krishna's dealing with Radha Rani and also with the gopis as some kind of loving affairs between an ordinary mundane man and a woman. When a mundane man and woman come together, you know, there is some element of so-called love, but actually it is one form of lust. Why we call it lust? Because both of them are interested in satisfying their own senses, their own minds, their own egos. It is said that Radharani is the pleasure potency of Krishna. Whatever we see in this world around us is nothing but Lord and his energies. So Lord also enjoys, he expands himself through his energies, expand himself as Radharani, as the gopis, and the embodiment of that pleasure potency, that energy which gives pleasure to the Lord is Radharani. It is his own energy. Just like if a rich man opens his almirah and takes out bundles of, let's say, 1,000 rupee notes or 2,000 rupee notes, he is not called a thief because it is his own notes. Whereas a dacoit who comes to that house in the middle of the night and removes that 500 rupee notes from the same cupboard, he'll be called a thief or a dacoit. So in this case, Radharani is the pleasure energy, that energy which gives pleasure to the Lord. Hence, the dealings of Radha and Krishna are very, very sublime. She is the greatest devotee. She gives lots and lots of pleasure to the Lord. She is the best devotee as far as serving the Lord is concerned. And because of her exemplary devotional qualities, people worship Radharani. And it is said that if we have to approach Krishna, rather than directly approaching Krishna, if we please Radharani and Radharani recommends that devotee to Krishna, then Krishna will surely accept that devotee. Therefore, if you see in Vrindavan, everyone is busy in serving Radharani, in glorifying Radharani, in pleasing Radharani, knowing that Radharani is very close to Krishna. And if she is pleased, if she recommends, then Krishna will surely accept such a devotee.
Yeah. Then what makes Krishna and Radha romance the epitome of all the romances?
It is said that the gopis, as I mentioned, are very, very dear devotees of the Lord. Let me share with you a small story in this regard. One time, Krishna had a headache. Now, it's a very surprising thing, but yes, God also has headache. God also has feelings. God also has emotions.
Yes, they have.
He is also a person, although he's not having a material body like us. So one time Krishna had headache, and Narada Muni, who happened to meet Krishna, he had gone to Vaikuntha. So he met Krishna and he got to know that Krishna is having a headache. So he asked Krishna, what will help alleviate you of this headache? How, what will solve this problem of headache? What will relieve you of this headache? So Krishna told that I'm aware of this fact that if the dust from the feet of my devotees is brought and placed on my forehead, if my forehead is smeared with that dust, my headache will go. So Narada Muni said, if that is so, then I know that there are great devotees in Vrindavan. I will go and get the dust. So Narada Muni goes to Vrindavan, and there he finds many, many Brahmanas who are engaged in a lot of worship, you know, worshipping Krishna, offering various items, doing yajnas. So Krishna, Narada Muni went and told them that Krishna is having a headache, and the cure for headache is to get the dust from the feet of the devotees. So can I take the dust of your lotus feet? So the Brahmana said, no, how can you do that? We will not allow that to happen. Don't you know that dust from our feet placed on the forehead of Krishna is as good as we stepping on the head of Krishna? It's a mahapap. We'll go to hell. We'll not allow this to happen. And although Narada Muni told that Krishna is having a headache, but still they were saying, we can't go to hell because of this great sin. And they refused. So Narada Muni went to Krishna and said, what to do? I went to Vrindavan, great hope that they'll give me the dust, but they are refusing. Because they're such great devotees that they don't want to step on your forehead, and they're refusing the dust out of respect for you. So Narada Muni, then Krishna said, okay, do one thing, then go to Radharani and ask the same question. Let's see what she does. So Narada Muni again goes back to Vrindavan, and this time he was not very high hopes, because last time also he went, he met great devotees, they all refused. So Krishna having told that, because Krishna knew the heart of Radharani and how much devotion and love she has for him. So when Narada Muni went to Radharani, and Narada Muni told Radharani that Krishna is having headache and it can be alleviated only when the dust from the feet of devotee is placed on his head. So Radharani said, immediately, please take the dust, go immediately. So Narada Muni said, wait a minute. Don't you know placing the dust from your feet on the head of Krishna is as good as you stepping on the head of Krishna? It's mahapap. You'll go to hell. For many, many lifetimes, you'll have to suffer. Don't you know that? Are you not worried about that? So Radharani says, I'm not at all worried about that. Krishna's headache should be solved. Does not matter. I go to hell. So this is what differentiates the gopis and the Radharani. Their love for Krishna is selfless. They don't mind going to hell if Krishna is pleased. Unlike our devotion is only when we are satisfied, then our devotion is intact. When our demands are fulfilled, we feel that yes, our bhakti is okay. But moment we face some difficulties or moment our wishes are not granted, we start doubting the existence of God. So therefore, the gopis and Radharani are exemplary devotees because their devotion is very selfless. They are all about giving pleasure and love to the Lord, to their beloved. And that is Lord Sri Krishna.
Such a wonderful bond and love bond and love relation between Radha and Krishna, and such a wonderful story that you have told us. So this epic story of Radha Krishna's eternal love bond can have positive impact on youth, because what is done nowadays, they are just involved in these love affairs and that are related to lust. They are related to some selfishness that is not pure as Radha Krishna's love was eternal. So it has some impact, or can it have some impact on youth?
Yeah. Good question. When we understand spirituality in right perspective and from right sources, when we understand the instructions of Bhagavad Gita, we'll be able to understand the difference between love and lust. We'll be able to understand the difference between real happiness and illusory happiness. I'll give you an example of illusory happiness. Just like when the fisherman goes to catch a fish, it will have a hook, and on the hook there'll be one bait, some worm dangling. And the fish will get attracted to that worm and will come to eat that worm. The fish does not know that behind that bait, behind that worm, there's a hook. And the fish will go and jump on that worm or that bait, and it will lose its life. Likewise, there are so many pleasures in this world which are very, very attractive, very, very alluring, very, very tempting. It is giving a lot of pleasure to the senses. For example, in today's world, a lot of adult content is available on the internet. And a lot of people get hooked on, and a lot of people get habituated, get addicted to all such content. Now, it gives pleasing pleasure to the senses immediately. But our scriptures say that, yehi samsparshaja bhoga dukha yona hi evate. This very pleasure, just like that fish, it got pleasure immediately. But behind that pleasure was a hook. And because of that, the fish gets caught and gets killed. So likewise, if we do not have the knowledge, the so-called pleasures in the world, which are very, very alluring, very, very tempting, we'll go for it, thinking that it will satisfy me, it will give me real pleasure. And in the process, we'll get entangled, we'll mess up our lives, and we'll become completely miserable. So with spirituality, like you said, if students at the young age have this knowledge, they'll be able to differentiate what is real pleasure and what is illusory pleasure. What are those things which I should go for, and what are those things which I should refrain from? What I should be doing, what I should not be doing. That discriminatory power will be there if we have the knowledge of spirituality.
Such a wonderful awakening session, Prabhuji. Even I am learning so many things from you. So, when we just differentiate between Maryada Purushottam Ram and when we talk about Krishna, Maryada Purushottam Ram, he was known for his 14 kalas, and Krishna is known for 16 kalas that they were expertise in. So Krishna, when we talk about Krishna's policies, it is included that with the Sam, Dam, Dand, Bhed, we can just apply and get whatever we want. So our youth is confused. Whom should be followed? Lord Rama or Krishna, applying with the policies of this Sam, Dam, Dand, Bhed, or 40, following this Maryada Purushottam Ram's limitations? How we see with our perspectives towards this?
Very good point. How to take out wonderful insights from the lives of great devotees, from Purushottam Ram, from Lord Sri Krishna? Actually, we require the help of an enlightened soul, a spiritual master, a guru. If we read scriptures directly without the help of an enlightened soul, we will interpret even scriptures according to our own opinions, according to our own understanding of life. To give you an example, Mahatma Gandhi, the father of a nation, he wrote a commentary on Bhagavad Gita, and he gave an interpretation that Bhagavad Gita is actually not a historical fact, the Battle of Kurukshetra. This battle is, this Pandavas and Kauravas is not a historical fact. It's basically a fight between vices and virtues.
Right.
And because he was practicing non-violence, he said, although Bhagavad Gita was spoken in a battlefield and Krishna was inspiring Arjuna to fight this battle, but he gave a twist to the whole understanding and to promote his philosophy of non-violence. So, if we just read scriptures on our own, quite possible we will just take those elements which is suiting us, and we will give our own interpretation to suit our minds. That's why we require a spiritual master who can guide us how to apply the teachings of Krishna, how to apply the teachings of Lord Ramachandra based on present circumstances, based on time, place and circumstances, how to apply those teachings, which teachings to apply. A guru can tell us. Srila Prabhupada, who is the guru of our movement, when he went to the West, he gave many practical instructions, keeping the principles intact. When he saw that boys and girls are intermingling, because in US it is a very pre-mixing society, as a sannyasi he got them married. Generally sannyasis is not supposed to encourage and, you know, involve in marriages and all that. He got them married, keeping the principle in mind that they should be regulated as far as their sense gratification is concerned. Therefore, even if we have to follow Krishna or Rama or any great personality, we need help of a self-realized soul, a guru who can tell us how we can practically apply those teachings in our lives based on the circumstances in which we are living.
Yes, it means like our scriptures are misinterpreted somewhere and they are acquiring that what they are looking for.
Exactly.
Yes. And in the way they are just following this in path that they are looking for, that they have to do this, in the same way they are acquiring what they are looking for and they are getting into it.
Yes. And in the name of scriptures. And they justify it in the name of scriptures.
Right. And because the proper guidance is not given to them, nobody is there, no guru is there to just show them the right direction.
Yeah. Okay. So what Prabhupada did was he created an institution where institution of his disciples and followers. So in our institution, we have Srila Prabhupada books to guide us, and on practical matters, on day-to-day matters, Prabhupada's instructions and guidance is available through his institution by his senior devotees, disciples, and all those things. So anybody who, let's say, comes to our institution, he will get primary guidance from Prabhupada books. He'll be reading it. But he may have a lot of doubts as far as practical application of this knowledge is concerned. That he can consult many senior devotees and experienced devotees, and he can get solutions to his problems.
To the viewers, those who are watching us, they can just take the help of Prabhuji, and whatever the guidance is being given by the Guru, that is the perfect guidance. So a person should be aware of that what he is learning from the scriptures, and he should be perfect in the knowledge that he is trying to get from there. Prabhuji, it is said, and we usually see in materialistic world, everybody is indulged in various activities of the daily life routines. They are busy with their schedules. They are not getting time to spend to pray for the God. They are not just sparing their time to remember the God with the pure soul. And when it comes to the old age, then they start praying to the God. This is the time. Old age is the time when we are remembering the God. And youth is the time we are just wasting it by indulging in so many unwanted activities. So why it is said that old age is the age of praying to God, worshipping God, and youth is and childhood is the age that it is the age of doing other activities, but they are forgetting God somewhere. They are forgetting the supreme power. So why it is said this old age is the age to worship the God?
Yeah, I have heard this many times when people start practicing spirituality at a young age. So parents say, this is not the time. This is a time for you to grow up in your career, earn a lot of money, get married, build your business, build your, you know, career. And post-retirement, yes, you can do all these things. Let me share this example with you. All of you are seeing this pen. Let's say this pen represents our life, the length of this pen. This tip, one side, represents the day we came in this world, the day we were born. And let's say the other end represents the day we are going to leave this world. Now, every one of us have a lifespan, the number of years which we have to spend here in this planet Earth where we have taken birth. So I have asked this question multiple times in many forums, in many training sessions. I have asked audience that if this pen represents the length of your life, the duration of your life, this is the starting point, this is the time where you're going to leave this world, where are you currently? So I have seen people coming up, standing up, and you know, somebody who is 25 years old, so he will come and he'll say, he'll put his hand here, I am somewhere here. Thinking that, okay, average lifespan is about 80 years, 100 years, so I am somewhere here. And then many of the people in the audience will start laughing. So I'll ask them, why are you laughing? So somebody will come and say, he cannot say surely. It's not 100% true that he is here. Because it's a fact that we think that one day when we'll become old, we will study spirituality or dabble in all the subject matter. But we cannot be sure that we're going to live for 100 years or 80 years. Life is short. Life is temporary. Life is uncertain. I'll share with you an example of one of our employees who was working in our temple 14 years. He was diagnosed with some kind of a fever and a lot of weakness. So he was rushed to the hospital and the doctor suspected something serious. And this was in Bangalore. And he was admitted to the hospital. And then doctor said, no, he should be sent to Kidwai Cancer Institute because they suspected some kind of symptoms of a cancer. So immediately next day, he was rushed to Kidwai Cancer Institute. Night time, his condition worsened. There was some clot in the brain hemorrhage happened. And the blood samples were taken for testing. Night, since the condition deteriorated, he was rushed to an ICU. And before the reports came in the morning, 10 o'clock, he was declared dead. Imagine a person, young person, he just got married 3 years back. He was, I think, 27 years old. He has a two-year-old child. He's working in the office, suddenly find some kind of weakness, tiredness, some kind of fever. He was rushed to the hospital. And then from there, he was suspected something about cancer. He was rushed to Kidwai Memorial Institute. And the next day, he's dead. If you see newspaper, every day you will come across so many accidents where young people have also lost their lives. So our scriptures say that this human form of life is very rare. Labdhva sudur labham idam bahu sambhavante. After many, many lives, we have got this human birth. So thinking that we have a lot of time at our disposal, that's why there's a doha. Kal kare so ab kare so. There is a saying, I forget the exact thing.
काल करे सो आज करे सो अब
पल में प्रलय होएगी तब करे सो आई डोंट नो द एग्जैक्ट वन हाँ सो दिस इज एग्जैक्टली फॉर कीपिंग इन माइंड दैट ह्यूमन फॉर्म ऑफ लाइफ इज वेरी रेयर एंड वी हैव अ वेरी वेरी स्पेशल ड्यूटी असतो मा सतगमया तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमया अथातो ब्रह्म जिज्ञासा नाउ दैट वी हैव गॉट दिस ह्यूमन फॉर्म ऑफ लाइफ we have to inquire into the self, who I am, what is the purpose of my life. Just like when we buy some instrument or a gadget, we get a manual. And before we use the gadget, we should consult the manual. We don't consult the manual after the product is fully used and we are about to discard the product. So this Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, Ramayana, Upanishads, Puranas, our Vedic literatures are like the manual which guides us how we can go about leading our lives. These are all not meant to be read post-retirement when we have already spent our life without proper understanding how we should lead our lives. What is the meaning of leading a successful life, a meaningful life? Without knowing that, once we have led our lives in old age, if we start reading this, it will not make sense also to us, because we would have spent our time already.
Yes. Right.
So that's why it is important at a young age we get exposed to. And this is not at all true that these all books are meant to be studied post-retirement. In fact, somebody who thinks that post-retirement, unless we have developed taste for reading these books post-retirement, even if you want to, you will not have a taste, you will not have inclination, you will not have a desire. We see a lot of people, old people, sitting and watching IPL, sitting and watching television, sitting and watching so many other things. But even though they have time, they will not spend time reading Bhagavad Gita because there's no taste for it.
A wonderful, wonderful session is going on and very interactive and very knowledgeable enhancing, just to awaken our consciousness. It means one should pray to God and one should spend the time whenever he gets the time, because life is not sure for tomorrow. So one should pray to God whenever he gets the time. He should be there with the God and just to get the blessings of the God. We cannot just make sure that tomorrow it's going to be there. So today is the life and live it at its fullest. It yes. doesn't mean that you just enjoy the life. Means make it meaningful.
Yeah.
So, Prabhuji, we have seen this pandemic has changed mind of humans somewhere to some extent. Maybe emotionally, they have some of them have become weak, or some of them are just they are becoming strong. They are trying to survive with this negative phase of the time. So I would like to ask this: does dharma and meditation is helpful in achieving spirituality? And has it really helped us in facing the pathetic scenario during the pandemic?
You're asking about meditation?
I'm asking, like, dharma and meditation, is it helpful in achieving spirituality? If yes, then how it has helped us in facing this, going through this pandemic, the negative phase?
First and foremost, just like Arjuna, in the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita, although some of us may not have fully read Bhagavad Gita, but at least we know Bhagavad Gita was spoken in the battle of Kurukshetra. In the first chapter, when Arjuna sees that he has to fight against his own relatives, own cousins, his own near and dear ones, Bhishma is there, Dronacharya is there, his worshipable elders are there, he becomes very bewildered. He becomes very confused. He even tells Krishna that, Krishna, my mind is reeling. I'm unable to stand any longer. I'm confused about my duty. And then he says that my bow, Gandiva, is slipping from my hand. I'm unable to stand any longer. And finally, Krishna, I will not fight. And he sits down, gives up his bow. In other words, he was very confused. He was very bewildered. He was overwhelmed with the situation he was in. And Krishna, after hearing all that, he spoke the message of Gita. And after hearing Gita, Krishna did not change his circumstances. Krishna did not change his situation. Krishna did not say, okay, you are in problem because you have to fight this battle. You go home, I'll fight the battle for you. Krishna also did not say, okay, now I'll make a situation like that, so therefore there is no need of battle. You don't have to fight at all. Many times we try changing the situations and circumstances, but we find that it is at times very difficult to change the situation and circumstance. For example, everywhere people are struggling to put an end to this pandemic, but still it is taking time. Till the right vaccine is found, till the vaccine is given to all the people, it will take time. So to change the situation and circumstances is relatively difficult. But what is relatively easy is to change our thinking.
State of mind, right.
Our state of mind. How do we interpret what is happening around us? And that is what Krishna did to Arjuna by speaking the Bhagavad Gita. So Einstein made this nice statement. He said, the challenges we face in life cannot be solved by being at the same level of thinking we were when we created those problems. So Arjuna was at one level of thinking when he created those problems. But Krishna changed his level of thinking. And with this changed level of thinking, changed perspective, the problem was solved. So likewise, in this pandemic also, not only in this pandemic, any problem of life, we strongly feel that Gita has solutions to all problems of life. If a person is going through family challenges, if a person is going through financial difficulties, if a person is going through mental problems, if a person is going through issues with his health. Now, Gita may not have specific solutions to each health problem. If you have sinus, this is a solution. If you have marital problem, this is a solution. If you have mind problems, Gita may not have specific solution, but it has a nice way of teaching how we should deal with our problems, how we should think. It gives us an empowered perspective of life. And if we have that empowered perspective, come what challenge we may encounter, not only this pandemic, any challenge we encounter in life, we will not get bewildered, will not get overwhelmed. We'll have a smile on our face and we'll boldly go through this challenge. This is what we are emphatically teaching people. Gita has solutions to all problems. All we have to do is, with humility, we have to understand this knowledge and apply that teachings in our day-to-day lives.
Very well said, Prabhuji. Because during this pandemic and during this lockdown, it was happening. Some of my relatives, some of my friends were saying, "Ab to Bhagavad Gita padhne ka time aa gaya. Just follow it. This is only the way of living." So they have to follow like this. कि अभी जो भगवत गीता है उसी का हमें follow करना है क्योंकि अब जो जीना है उसके according जिएंगे तो हम खुश रहेंगे नहीं तो इस COVID-19 से निकलना बहुत मुश्किल है. Everybody was discussing like this. And really it teaches us the way to live and to encounter with our problems.
Yeah.
So Prabhuji, it is an interactive session and even I'm getting more and more and I'm trying to get more and more from you. The curiosity is more to learn more about these awakening session, more about this spirituality, more about Bhagavad Gita. And there is not an end to the spirituality. The more we learn, the more we get, and more we become curious to learn more about this. So in the last, I would like to ask that what message would you like to give to our new generation and youth so that they can be the strong pillar of a nation?
I would say that a lot of people ask, is earning money, going for career growth, having some materialistic goals, is it wrong? Sometimes people think spirituality means you should not be, this money is all Maya. So we should not run behind money. We should not have any attachments. We should not have any desires. Sometimes people think spirituality means you should say no to happiness. Swami Prabhupada was once asked, Prabhupada, what is the goal of your movement? So Prabhupada said, the goal of our movement is to enjoy life. So spirituality is not saying that you should not enjoy life. Spirituality is not saying that you should not earn money. Spirituality is not saying that you should not have aspirations in life. Spirituality is not saying that you should not have desires. Spirituality is all about having right goals, having right desires, seeking right happiness. There's nothing wrong in growing, but growing in the right direction. So all I am saying is whatever desires, whatever goals, whatever aspirations you have, just make sure that it is balanced with the right understanding of life, which we get from our scriptures. Better late than never. Something is better than nothing. This time we had a program on 1st Jan on the occasion of New Year. So I told all the participants, just make a resolution that every day you will read 2 verses from Bhagavad Gita. 2 verses. It will take less than 2 minutes. And since we have 365 days, there are 700 verses. So whole year, if you just read two verses, spend 2 minutes, 3 minutes every day, you would have completed the Bhagavad Gita in the whole year. And at the end of the year, you will have so much of satisfaction that you have completed Bhagavad Gita. We as Indians, everyone knows that Bhagavad Gita is an important book. Everyone has Bhagavad Gita in the house, but we don't have time to read it. So all I'm saying is add this knowledge to your life. You don't have to bring about drastic changes in your life. We are not saying you resign your job. We are not saying that whatever goals you have are wrong. All we are saying is add this knowledge. Automatically, you will have the wisdom to select which are the goals, which goals are right goals, which desires you should pursue, which you should not pursue. That knowledge and wisdom will be there with you, and automatically you will be able to make the right choices. So our message to everyone, not even youngsters, even everyone, is add this knowledge, add this wisdom to your life, this gyan to your life, which is not very difficult. It is easily accessible. In fact, people can read online. Sometimes people may say, I don't have a book. You can read it free online. And with that knowledge, with that wisdom, go about leading your life. For sure, you will come out successful.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Thank you. It was really an interesting session, and it was very knowledgeable session. And I would really like to thank Prabhuji for sparing your valuable and precious time with us. And to my viewers, those who are watching this show, I'm sure that you have learned a lot about the way of living, the art of living practically, and way we should live the life. And I'm also proud that I'm here just to interact with Prabhuji. You have enriched my mind also. And I'm also thinking that I would be following these preaches of the Gita. We are trying to follow, but somewhere, being a common man, being a normal human, we are not getting time to get into it. And to my viewers also, I would like to say, the session was very interactive and very knowledgeable enhancing. And we tried, with the help of Gyanam Foundation, we are trying to incorporate these spiritual values in all the humans without making any disadvantages of dharma, without making any disadvantages of this religion, rather of any caste, creed, or any discrimination. Because our motto is just to inculcate that harmony, spirituality, that nobility, that integrity, that harmony among all. And I think that we are little bit successful in doing this. Those who are watching us, they should learn, because these are the values that should be there in everybody's life. These are the values to be followed by everybody. Thank you, Prabhuji, for sparing your precious and valuable time with us again and awakening our soul and just leaving us with that positivity in our mind, lead the life with positive attitude. Thank you, and Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.
Platform to sharing your thoughts.